This grooving shrubbery in Hi-Fi Rush gave me a mild, multi-angled identity crisis. And I'm not even kidding. Hi, I'm Christina, I'm a designer, and I make games. You see, whenever I built games or prototypes, I ran into the same issue. They looked rigid, super immobile, frozen popsicle levels kinda stiff. And I just hadn't even realized it. It always felt like something was missing, but I couldn't put my finger on it. But while playing Hi-Fi Rush, I just caught myself staring at them. So, let's have a closer look at the shrubbery again. It doesn't just sit there, gently swaying in some invisible breeze. It's grooving to the beat of the music, shrinking and expanding. Stuff shrubbery shouldn't do, but feels just so right and just plain fun to watch. This effect is called squash and stretch. It's been used for ages in animated series, movies, and games. It refers to the compression and expansion of objects to exaggerate motion or show impact. This helps to convey weight and elasticity and brings life and flexibility to objects. Of course, it's always a question if stuff actually should squash and stretch when working on our projects, because it conveys squishiness that doesn't work well for everything in every context. In this tutorial, we are going to write a script that squashes and stretches objects, no matter if they are 2D, 3D, or UI elements. This tutorial will first cover how to write the script and then give a few use cases. Hope you'll enjoy it. Let's get into it. You should start with something in your scene you want to add the effect to, of course. This can just be a basic cube. Create a new script called squash and stretch. These are all the namespaces you'll need, by the way. The Odin inspector one only if you have and want to use Odin. It's not mandatory, but we can find a few cool use cases for it in this script you might enjoy. Starting with the core settings. The header attribute will group like-minded values under one common headline, which will make working with the script in the inspector a lot more enjoyable. We need a transform we want to affect. In case it gets left unset, our code will default to the game object it's sitting on. So I'll add a tooltip to it to remind me if I need it. First Odin use case, add a child game object only. It will give you a drop-down to pick a child element, which can make setting up a lot easier. We need to tell our script which axis of the object we want to affect, x, y, z, or a combination. To do so, we create a new enum called squash stretch axis with none x, y, and z values and give it the flex attribute. This turns an enum dropdown into a dropdown with elements to toggle. Because it is decorated with flags, you will be able to apply the effect to multiple axes at once by selecting a combination of options. For example, if we wouldn't use flags, we would need to write a long list of entries and later check for each of them. The flags attribute allows for the needed flexibility and shortens the amount of code and checks we have to write down the line. Use it in the axis to effect value. I recommend defaulting it to the Y axis so you'll see the effect even if you forgot to set up the proper direction. Next is the animation duration. This will get a range attribute, as this effect really looks the best with quick timing. Also, the Odin suffix label adds a small reminder for the measurements to the box. The remaining two values are two bools. One to check if our animation can be overwritten. For example, if I have a game in which things react to the beat, but I also want to call the effect manually when specific things happen, I toggle it on. The second one checks if we want the animation to play on start. Next up are the animation settings. We need an initial scale, which defaults to 1, and the maximum scale, which relates to the biggest scale we want this effect to reach. The third value is a bool for us to check in case we want to reset our transform back to its initial scale after the animation is over. The fourth value we need is an animation curve. When we don't initialize our animation curve, the default is just no animation at all. That's why we are going to create a very simple one in code like this. A new animation curve with an array of keyframes. We need an initial keyframe at 0 time and 0 value, a keyframe at time 1 and the value of 0, and one for the in-between. A time value of 0.25 with a value of 1 will give us a more snappy effect, but one with 0.5 time with a value of 1 also looks very nice. You can just set a different curve or tweak the values in the inspector afterwards, of course. Third up are the looping settings. They just need to check if we actually want to loop, and a delay. We will be using a coroutine in the script, so let's create a reference to it up here as well. And since we might want to loop and have a delay for that, we should also add a wait for seconds here too. The initial size of our object will be saved to a vector 3. The last values we need are all relating to our chosen axes: effect X, effect Y, and effect Z. We check if we chose the specific axis in our flagged enum, and this will return true if we did, false if we didn't. That's been quite a start to the script, hasn't it? But the hardest part is now over, I think. Methods are next, and we are going to start with awake. If our transform to effect is null, we will just use the transform of the object this script is sitting on. We also set the initial vector scale, as well as the wait for seconds in here. Before we start our coroutine, we need to do a few checks. If our axis is set to none, we might want to be notified about that. Adding the GameObject behind the comma will highlight the offending GameObject in the hierarchy if we click on the message in the console. We assign the coroutine to our squash and stretch coroutine like this, and need to make sure there is not already a coroutine running. That would lead to our animation partially overwriting itself, resulting in strangely deformed results. If there is already a routine running, we stop it and set our local scale back to the initial scale vector. We call this method in start, in case we want our animation to play on start, that is. Also, we need a public method to call from other scripts that will play the animation. We just need to make sure that in the case our animation is set to be looping and we don't want that to be overwritten, we return out of there before calling the check. Because I don't want to add any buttons to my scene to test this behavior, I'll either add a button attribute to this method, in case you have own, or a context menu entry, in case you don't. Button will add a button to click, context menu will add an entry to click when you right-click on your component. Both are super handy for quick testing. Just be sure to be in play mode, since our coroutine won't work in the editor. Next up is the heart of the system itself: the coroutine squash and stretch effect. We start with a do while loop. This means we want this method to do this block of code at least once, and if we set looping to true, it will repeat the process until told to stop. Elapsed time will keep track of how far along in our animation we are. We also want to save the original scale of the object and reset the modified scale to that original one, because we are going to be working with these two. We need to repeat the next block of code as long as our elapsed time is less than the animation duration. Let's get math involved. We add the time.delta time to our elapsed time first. Then we calculate a curve position to track the progress of the animation. We need the value to check where in our animation curve we are currently positioned. We need a remap value, meaning we are going to add the value we found at the curve position's time on the animation curve and make sure it's between our initial scale and maximum scale. To make sure our next calculations won't run into any divide by zero issues, we are going to use a minimum threshold to check against. If our remap value is less than the minimum threshold, it will be set to it. Next are the checks for the axis. A good squash and stretch tries to keep the volume of the object being affected, which means if it gets stretched in one direction, the other direction needs to shrink accordingly. We can achieve it like this. We check if we want to affect a specific axis. If true, we will set the modified scale of that axis to the original scale multiplied by the remapped value. If we don't want to affect it, which is kind of ironic now that I think about it, we are going to divide the value instead. Then we set the local scale to the modified scale and yield return null, which signals the while loop to wait for the next frame. This whole while loop basically checks every frame where we are located on the animation curve and apply the calculated value to our affected transform. Working like this also means you can add a smaller number as the maximum amount. It will then just shrink the specific axis direction. Alright, now that the while loop is over, we will reset the affected transform back to its original scale in case we wanted to. If we don't, it will keep the scale it reached until the next time it's being called to squash and stretch. In case we want to loop, we will make our loop wait for the specified duration, after which it will start another do while loop. Lastly, add a public set looping method so we can control it from the outside. Testing time! As there are while loops involved, I heavily suggest saving your scene before you hit play. I hope your result looks similar to mine, but you can find the script on my GitHub in case things look a bit wonky. And before we continue to add some cool extra features, if this tutorial has been helpful so far, please leave it a like to let me know. Sometimes we might want to squash and stretch into one direction and only squash and stretch back when something specific happens. Add the bool check for it at the top with a private tracker for it if the animation needs to be played in reverse. Inside the coroutine, we need to change our curve position based on this check like this. Let's check! Yep, looks good. Next, we might want to play with a certain percentage chance. Add another bool and a float to the percentage. Give it another range attribute too. Next comes a check if the animation will actually play. Then, in our check method, change this line so it will only be applied in the case the animation plays every time and should be reset afterwards. Do you want every single element with squash and stretch to react at certain points? For example, if you picked up something special or fell from a really high height? Create a private static event action called squash and stretch all objects like this, and create a similarly called method invoking it. Subscribe to it and unsubscribe from it in onEnable and onDisable respectively. Now, if you call this method from outside, everything will animate at once. Just keep in mind that you might have to enable overwriting and place every time accordingly, depending on your needs. And let's see some examples in action. First, UI. And since honestly, I had started this with UI in mind. It just kinda got out of hand real quick. You have a bunch of buttons. Add squash and stretch to them. Set it up with X and Y, and add an event handler. In onHover, it should play the animation. On-click as well. This leads to a first cool effect. And for these shadows, I added an image to a child element and positioned it so the parent's pivot is in the upper right corner. Next up, 3D. I have a rough basic building system in place. Whenever I click and add an element, I want it to squash and stretch. To achieve this, just add squash and stretch to the objects and enable play on awake. If you don't want them to animate based on their center, you'll need to wrap the model in another game object and position it like the shadow example from before. And one more example, this time a little bit more complex yet, a 2D character. The quark graphic should get a breathing animation with squash and stretch like this. At the end of this tutorial, this sentence will not make sense anymore. That object will now be wrapped in another object, which will handle the landing animation. Lastly, yet another object to wrap all of this in for the jumping. That way, all the animations can flow into one another. Make sure to position the elements accordingly. It depends a bit on the shape and goal you have in mind for the animation, honestly. I at least finally got my grooving shrubbery all set up. From here, it's up to you. If you like tutorials like these, subscribe! I'm focusing my tutorials on everything design related primarily. Also, I have a Discord. Maybe I'll see you there. Have a great week!